18, 23 to 24. Did you know that life is a contest? From the time of your birth, there has been a contest for your soul, your family, your destiny, and ultimately your faith in God. Paul in Ephesians 6 verse 11 encourages believers to put on the full armor of God because we are in a contest. In Ephesians 6 verse 12, we wrestle not against flesh and blood, but against evil powers. It is time for revival. It is time to bring back the glory to the body of Christ. Join the Mama Brothers as they expose the works of the enemy so that you can manifest the glory of the Lord. The contest, glory, back to the body of Christ.
Greetings in the wonderful name of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. I welcome you to tonight's meeting, the contest, the Mamba Brothers. This program that is brought to you, courtesy of KBN TV. Thank you so much to the management of KBN. Thank you to Pastor Kenneth and the team for allowing me to come and be in this position to speak to the nation of Zambia. Everyone that is watching, everyone that is listening, I want you to know that God loves you. It is a blessing that I can be received in your homes. Those who are watching us via Facebook, what a wonderful time. So I think I haven't preached in some few weeks, but by the grace of God, we are here. Let us pray together. Eternal and everlasting Father, we give you praise. We give you glory. The earth is the Lord's and the fullness thereof, the world and all that dwell therein. God in his wisdom has given us this time to be in his presence. For in the presence of the Lord, there is fullness of joy at his right hand. There are pleasures evermore. In your calendar, you allowed this day that I'll stand and declare your word. There is power in the name of your son Jesus. For there is no other name given under the sun by which man must be saved except the name of your son Jesus. We call upon this name. For whosoever shall call upon the name of the Lord shall be saved. I commend this time into your hands. Let the presence of your Holy Spirit abide with us. Speak to us. Minister to us. Let your word bring forth light. Give us understanding. Speak to us. In Jesus' most precious name, we pray with thanksgiving in our heart. Amen. I've come with a very, very interesting subject that I want us to discuss this evening. I'm talking about the power of sacrifice, the power of sacrifice. Now, Mount Moriah Christian Fellowship, the church that I'm coming from, the church that I pastor, by the grace of the Lord himself appointed me before the foundation of the world. I remember my mother when I was young, she would be talking to me and say, you know what, Emmanuel, my prayer to God is that one of my sons must be a pastor. Now, two of us, we are pastors by the grace of the Lord. Thank God that the prayer of that woman, may her soul rest in peace, was answered by the Lord. Now, at Mount Moriah, the name Mount Moriah is a mountain where God had called his servant Abraham to say, you need to come and sacrifice your son Isaac. You need to give me your son. You need to give me your son. And then the Bible says Abraham rose early in the morning. He sandaled his donkey. He told his workers, he says, let's go to Mount Moriah. And they began to go. And the Bible says on the third day, because God was quiet throughout the way, God was silent for 3 days. Then on the third day, Abraham sees the place from afar. And he says, that is the place when you know when God has called you, when you get to what God has called you to do, you will be able to know this is what he asked me to do. No one can lie to you. No one can take it away from you. Somebody says when you go in the shop and you are looking for a suit, you know the workers in the boutique, they'll come and say, try this one. You tell them, no, not that one. Try. Then they say, but which one are you looking for? You say, I don't know, but when I see it, I'll know it. Your court neighbor says, when I see the suit, I know my taste. When I see it, I'll know it. So Abraham was going when he got to the mountain. Even without God telling him, you are here, he knew this is a place. And then he says to the workers, you stay here with the donkey while me and the lad must go yonder to worship. You know, the work of the Lord at Mount Moriah, we have 9 pillars. The first pillar is hearing the voice of God. The second pillar is obedience. The third pillar is faith. The fourth pillar is people. Of course, there are people that will go with you, but then there comes a time that you must separate with what knows you. You must separate with the acquaintance. You must separate with the friends. There must be a time of going yonder. There must be a time of separation. To go alone, the place of worship is a place of separation. The place of sacrifice is a place of separation. I'm talking about the power of sacrifice. So one of the pillars of Mount Moriah, from the place, we call it worship. And after worship, the other pillar is called sacrifice. Now, I want to bring it home that God called Abraham to say, go to Mount Moriah to go and sacrifice your only son. There are only 2 people in the Bible who are called the only son, Isaac and Jesus. Your only son. And you know that Isaac was a proxy of the Messiah who was going to be crucified, who was going to die on the cross. That's why when John the Baptist saw him, he says, behold the Lamb of God that takes away the sin of man. You cannot take away the sin of others unless you yourself, you have not committed sin, because the lambs they were sacrificing are lambs that had no blemish. They had to keep this lamb for 14 days, and the priest was supposed to inspect this lamb 3 times in 14 days to make sure that it meets the standards and the requirements. It has no blemish. It has no spot. It is not lame. It doesn't have any imperfection, because God wanted the best. So he says to Abraham, give me your son. And then Abraham is going to the mountain. Then the son says to him, Dad, I can see the firewood. I can see the knife, but where is the lamb for sacrifice? Isaac knew something. The father had taught him something, that you don't appear before God empty-handed. Isaac knew something in the spirit, that every time you are going to raise an altar, sacrifice is an integral part. He says to the father, I can see the knife. I can see the firewood. Where is the lamb for sacrifice? He didn't know in that moment that he was actually the one intended. Then Abraham prophetically speaks to the son and says, my son, don't worry. God himself will provide the lamb. You know the beauty about God is that he provides bread for the eater and seed to the sower. He supplies bread to the eater and seed to the sower. The key for every man is to know which one is bread, which one is a seed. It becomes disastrous when in the time of sowing, we eat the seed for bread. Now, Abraham and Isaac get to the mountain, and Abraham binds his son on the altar and is about to sacrifice him. Now here is Isaac, no crying, no pushing, no accusing the father. I can imagine the young boy, the tears are running down his cheeks while he's looking to God. Now, Paul, the writer of the book of Hebrews, who bring it to us in the patriarchs of faith in Hebrews chapter number 11, that Abraham walked with Isaac according to chapter number 11 of the Hebrews. By faith, Abraham sacrificed Isaac his son. As they were walking for 3 days, Isaac was already dead. As far as Abraham was concerned, that which was promised was already laid on the altar. That which God had promised, that which he waited for 25 years, he was ready to lay it on the altar
Oh my God. God, how could it be that that which I thought I waited for, that which I thought I worked for, that is what you are asking me to give you? God says, give it to me. Wow. Isaac is laid on the altar. But Paul says, he believed in God who raises the dead. Oh my God. Abraham had so much faith that if God can make my body, which was as good as dead, to be quicker than the son at the age of 99 to 100. And my wife Sarah at the age of 90, her body was quickened to conceive, and her womb was able to keep this boy for 9 months. There is nothing too impossible with God. If God can make that womb of my wife to keep this child for 9 months, how can God fail to raise my son? If he raised my body, he can raise this child. Listen, child of God, when you get to any stage of life where things are not making sense, trust God based on what he has done before. You can use other people's testimonies. You can use other people's experiences and get encouraged that if they have managed to do this, I can do it, I can do it, I can do it, I can do it. I want to encourage you that God is able. Abraham had so much faith in God that God was able to raise this Isaac from the dead. He lays the boy on the altar. I can only imagine the song that was going through this child. He was saying, just take me as I am. Lord Jesus, you died for me. Just take me as I am. I can imagine Isaac says, I surrender. Oh, I surrender. Oh, to thee, my blessed Savior. I surrender. I can imagine Isaac singing, I have decided to follow Jesus. Oh, withholding nothing, withholding nothing, withholding nothing. Brethren, people that sacrifice withhold nothing. People that sacrifice, they don't care. What is sacrifice? Sacrifice is giving something of value to a deity as an offering. Sacrifice is giving something of value to the deity. A deity, a God. It can be to God, Jehovah, or it can be to Satan, the God of this world. With sacrifice from different, it depends on the altar that you are using. It depends on the date that you are taking your sacrifice. There is so much sacrifice going on now. Christians, most believers are ignorant about sacrifice. I always give an example. That if I'm going to town from mass media, and then I find you at Christian Voice bus stop, and you say to me, Pastor, I'm going to town, can you drop me? Or you say, I'm going to Kamwala, drop me by the bus stop there. Then I say, fine, it's on the route. That is not sacrifice. That is like an offering, because I am just giving you from what I already have, because that's where I'm going. But sacrifice is when I get to that bus stop, I'm going to town, then you say, Pastor, I'm asking for a favor. My mother is sick and I'm going to see you, Varest. Are you able to drop me, please, an emergency? If I turn around and go to Silverest, where I never intended to go, that becomes a sacrifice. Sacrifice must cost you. Abraham, it costed him his son. Now, there's so much that is going on in the Christian circles, and people tell you, Jesus paid the price. Yes. He paid the price for us to be born again. No one can buy salvation. It is free. Freely we received, freely we give. Jesus paid the price. But let me tell you, we will never be on the same level as believers. The level of your sacrifice will determine your position, will determine the heaviness of your anointing. You cannot be a pastor and you are eating from January to December, you cannot be a man of God. Your prayer altar is dry. You don't fast, you don't pray. You don't read your Bible and you say, Jesus died on the cross, I'll be powerful. You will not. I can tell you, even the spiritual world knows how to understand sacrifice. They know how to understand. They know the demons who say, Jesus, we know. And the poor, we know. Who are you? Show me your altar. Which altar is sponsoring him? The Bible says there was a man of God from Judah. He went into the land and he found the king sacrificing on an altar. And he never spoke to the king. He spoke to the altar because the man is as powerful as his altar. What makes an altar powerful is the sacrifice that is put on that altar. What is rising from the heart that you carry? What incense is rising? What sacrifice is laid on your heart? I was talking to one of the fathers in the land, our spiritual fathers, and he's an old man going into 70, and he was saying, my son, I do 3 overnights every week. 3 overnights. I said, I need Jesus. If a man who is turning 70 can do 3 overnights, and a youth like me is failing, brethren, we cannot walk at the same wavelength in the spirit. There are things he can handle. Let me tell you that what we cast out are demons. They are principalities. They are powers. They are principalities that when Jesus is finishing prayer and fasting, and the devil comes to him, and he says, let's negotiate here. These are things that, principalities are displaced by another powerful principality. My God. The church need to come to a realization that the language of the spiritual realm is sacrifice. In the spiritual realm, when you introduce yourself, your sacrifice introduces you. In the spiritual realm, your title don't matter. In the spiritual realm, how long you've been fed, your background don't matter. Your order of sacrifice matters. That's what distinguishes you. That is what introduces you. Even before Jesus spoke to the demons, when he came crossing over, the demon says, Master, why have you come to judge us before our time? Jesus is already known. Even before he speaks a word, the demons know who he is. The Bible continuously said the demons knew him. He would command them to be quiet because they knew who he was. Let me shock you. The demons know who you are. They know all your secrets. They know your background. They can go 10, 15, 20 generations past. They know the father to your grandfather that you don't even know. They know the weaknesses that your father to your grandfather had. They know the weaknesses in your family. They can trace the bloodline. And when you come out to challenge the demon will say, where are you coming from? The man of God from Judah, he went and spoke to the altar, and he says, O altar, thus says the Lord, you shall be broken. You shall break into pieces, and there shall rise a son who is going to fight you. And the Bible says the altar broke into pieces. And when the king tried to stretch a hand against the man of God, he forgot that once the altar is compromised, his authority is compromised. Can I talk to you? If the devil wants to finish you, he begins by destroying your altar. Once your altar is tempered with, once your prayer life goes down, once your sacrifice goes down, you are finished. The moment the church stops praying, fasting, giving, sacrificing, giving to the poor, we are gone. The language of the spiritual realm is sacrifice. Listen, child of God, respect anyone who understands the principle of sacrifice, even if they worship Satan. Fear them. Respect anybody who understands the principle of sacrifice, even if they worship Satan. That's why nobody can join Satanism unless they are taught to sacrifice. Because in this kingdom, in the spiritual realm, the language they speak is sacrifice. The position is attained by sacrifice. You cannot ascend in the spiritual realm without sacrifice. Jesus does not overlook sacrifice. That's why when the centurion came to Jesus and says, "Master, I am asking for my servant to be healed." And Jesus says, no, I can't help you because you don't deserve. The people says, "Master, he deserves it because he built a sanctuary, a synagogue for us." Jesus says, "On the premise of this sacrifice, go." So let's go to your home. And he says, "You don't need to come to my home. Just speak a word." And just says, "I've never seen." The Bible says the very hour the servant was healed, Cornelius was giving alms and praying. The Bible says the angel of the Lord says, "Your giving and your prayer has risen to God as a memorial." As a memorial. Sacrifice. Pastor, you haven't even read the Bible. Listen, 2 Samuel chapter number 24. 2 Samuel chapter 24, verse 17. "And David spake unto the Lord when he saw the angel of the Lord that he smote the people, and said, 'Lo, I have sinned and have done wickedly. But this sheep that they have, whatever have they done? Let thine hand, I pray thee, be against me and against my father's house.' And God came that day to David and said unto him," and God, sorry, the prophet God said to him, "Go up, raise an altar unto the Lord in the threshing floor of Arunah the Jebusite." The prophet, after David did census, and there was calamity in the family, there was calamity in the nation. Listen, when you are a leader, be careful the decisions you make. They can cost the nation. They can cost a nation. They can cost a family. They can cost your children. They can cost your future. If you are a father in the home, be careful what you do. If you are sleeping around, you're doing all evil things, you are opening a door to the devil. In the leadership position, decisions you make can affect generations after you. David made a decision as an individual. 70,000 innocent people died because David erred. David is crying to God, "Please take my life. These people are innocent. 70,000 are already gone." Then the prophet comes to David and says, "There are things you cannot stop simply by talking to God. There are things you cannot stop simply by prayer. There are certain realms that invokes a sacrifice. You need to lose something of value. You need to let go of something for you to grab certain things." That's why in the spiritual world, they know sacrifice. As I'm speaking, if there is a Satan is watching me, you know what I'm talking about. You know what I'm talking about. And that's why I'm not scared of you. I don't fear you. I don't fear witches. Because I know your secret is sacrifice and altars. I know. But can I talk to you? The blood of Jesus is powerful. My connection is to Calvary. Every time I'm sacrificing, I am connected to Calvary. Every altar I raise, I am connected to the highest altar. That is Golgotha, where the Son of David died, where I said, the Lord, lama sabachthani, my Father, my Father." Night to go and kneel before God. If you cannot turn in the presence of God for hours, my brother, my sister, oh, kulibechako, this world is a world of a contest. He who was the strongest altar, he would take the dead. That's why when Goliath came to David, the Bible says Goliath was a champion. Goliath was a big man. Goliath had even an armor bearer in front of him. Goliath had a spear like a beam Oh my God. Ichipochabazesco. He had a spear as big as that. Imagine with all the experience against a small boy. He's saying to David, am I a dog that you are coming with to me with sticks and leggings? He's saying, why are you sending me a small boy? He's despising David, but he knows that in this world, nothing just happens. This guy, Goliath, he takes the battle from the physical into the spiritual. The Bible says he began to curse David by his ghost. He began to invoke the spiritual realm. He began to invoke his altar. He began to invoke his altar. When he began to interrupt, the Bible says every tongue that rises in condemnation of him, in judgment of you, you shall condemn. You shall condemn. It's not time to keep quiet. When they speak, I speak back. When they curse, I bless. When they insult, I bless them. The Bible says, do not keep quiet. When Goliath spoke, David spoke back. He says, you come to me with a javelin, with a spear, but I'm coming against you in the name of Jehovah Yahweh, the God of the hosts of Israel, whom you are insulting. Who are you, uncircumcised Philistine, that you are defying the armies of the Lord? David says, if you escalate this battle into the spirit, I'll escalate it even better, because my altar is more powerful, because my sacrifice. David, from young old age, he knew, he understood the power of sacrifice. He understood the power of sacrifice. He says to Goliath, if you are taking it in the spiritual, bring it on, bring it on, bring it on. That is the music to my, that's what I like. Because the one in me is greater than the one in the world. Because I know I can do all things through Christ who strengthens me. Because I know soon the Lord will crush Satan under my feet. Because I know the Lord said to my Lord, sit at my right hand until I make your enemies your footstool. The position of Satan is under my feet. What more you? The uncircumcised Philistines. I'll destroy you. Every Philistine in your life. Every Goliath in your life. I declare by the Spirit of the Lord. Let that evil Goliath come down. Let that evil Goliath come down. Every situation that has been speaking, that has been cursing, that has been enchanting, may the Lord silence them today. May their head be cut off using their sword. You will survive. You will survive. David is stood to go and raise an altar. Now let's see. You don't raise an altar for nothing. And David, according to the saying of God, went up as the Lord commanded. And Arunah looked and saw the king and his servants coming on towards him. And Arunah went out and bowed himself before the king upon and his face to the ground. And Arunah said to David, wherefore is my lord the king come to his servant? And David said, to buy the threshing floor from you, to build an altar unto the Lord, that the plague may be stayed from the people. I have come to buy the threshing floor. First I'll buy land from you, then I'll build an altar to the Lord, so that this problem can come to an end. Don't play. Osa joking and joking and alive. Life is spiritual. Ba mambala bari komemiti. Hey, ba anko bari wina. People are so rich. Hey, they don't show you what they do behind closed doors. They don't show. Tabalala ba mambala. They don't sleep. They sacrifice. They talk to snakes in the night. They go under the washings. Unfortunately, sorry to say, even some people are performing miracles today. I'm sorry to say. I'm not against miracles. God is a miracle worker. I believe God works miracles. But there are certain charlatans, certain guys who are using the gospel for their gain. Judgment is coming. The owner of the church is coming. He said, I'm building my church and the gates of hell shall not prevail. Iwe mambala iwe. Why some kubo mfya Bible? Emo lefa yoku inina. Ulevo mfya Bible. ukona iwe iwe Jesus ataka kuleke wilangana na Jesus iwe Jesus te wakwangalira ko abantu baisa bali bo broken baisa ku church iwe iwe haya haya be careful. Don't play with God's people. Abantu bako alisa te bako yes te wakupepera kufuaka. Don't listen, child of God. There are people who are masquerading to be pastors because they feel this is the easiest way I can win loyalty. Especially our women folk, they are being misled. May God help us. May God help us. But there is a remnant. That I can tell you there is a, they are genuine men and women of God. Even me who is preaching here, I'm not going to tell you whether I'm genuine or I'm saying, taste the Spirit. If truly the Spirit of the Lord resides in you, you should be able to pick whether this man speaking to you is genuine or is fake. Because I can pretend all I want. Jesus be glorified. Jesus be lifted. And Jesus be honored. Yeah, we bless you, Son of David. Takwabo abanga Yesu. Ela takwa kabe. Takwani. Takwaba. Takwa kabe. He is in the class of his own. He stands out among his brethren. For who among the angels did God say, today I have begotten you. You are my son. Come and sit at my right hand. You are my priest after the order of Melchizedek. Jesus! Be glorified. Jesus, be lifted on high. I love you, Jesus. Yes, you are worthy. David comes to Arunah. Verse 22 of 1 Samuel chapter number 24. And Arunah said to David, let my lord the king take and offer up what seemeth good unto him. Behold, here is the oxen for burnt sacrifice, and the threshing instruments, and other instruments of oxen and wood. Which means David, vonse nzaku pasa mahala, iwe buela chabyo fakepo pempelo. Listen to the answer. Verse 23. And all these things did Arunah as king gave unto the king. As he gave unto the king, and Arunah said to the king, the Lord thy God accept thee. Then the king said to Arunah, David said to Arunah, no, but I'll surely buy it from you at a price. Neither will I offer burnt offerings unto the Lord my God of that which cost me nothing. Never, never, never. I was saying to the church, I have never given money to anybody more than I have ever given to God. I can't remember an amount of money that I gave to an individual, an amount of money that I've never given to God, either through offering, through tithe, through sacrifice, or whichever giving. Never. David says, I'll never give to God that which costs me nothing. Umuntunga lepe peshamailo. Muntunga talalikila mailo. Muntunga taimbisa mailo. Wamene anagona pagua ama mveka. Nyimbo za mene zichoka pagua zimveka. Pempelo ya mene ishoka paota. Imveka. Manyimbo ya mene yachoka paota. Ya mveka. Olo kambebuanja, the Holy Ghost is here. I sense him. Olo lile ngatsia limo. Ambe katsia limo. Vamulungu, you can't fake them. Your sacrifice and your altar introduces you. The moment you stand in front, there is just this aura of glory that surrounds you. There is just this presence that overshadows you. Oh, keberu samakade. La 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 la. Echo tulari la paota. Mulandua sacrifice. Hey, Jesus, Jesus. Listen, child of God. What will distinguish you is sacrifice. David says, I'm not going to give anything that does not cost me nothing. And David built there an altar unto the Lord and offered burnt offerings and peace offerings. So the Lord was entreated for the land, and the plague was stayed from Israel. The Lord listened. David went to cry to God. It was quiet. God spoke to God. Go and tell him to raise an altar and put a sacrifice. He was offered. Alabantu bakonda bamara. Abusa mnipepelele nina problem. Okay, my sister, can we declare prayer and fasting next week? Koma, lekani ganizepo. Oh, bamene mwakamba, niliko naka program amalume anabwela. So, yeah, antwa mulungu. Hey. You know, that's why we are being used by these so-called papas. Because in your mind, you think the pastor should do everything for you. He should pray. You are just watching. He should read the Bible on your behalf. He should fast on your behalf. Oh, come on, man. Come on, man. That is not Christianity. If your pastor is teaching you that, he's misleading you. The disciple says to Jesus, teach us to pray, even as John the Baptist taught his disciples. That is how a pastor must work with his congregation. Your pastor must, even if the pastor fasts more, he must lead the congregation to fast. He must lead the congregation to prayer. Because there will be moments when your pastor is not around and you need to stand and pray alone. Yeah. I must just compliment, I must just supplement on what is on your life. Higher, higher. That is me preaching. After David raised an altar and put a sacrifice there, God had... When this word entreated, it is also used in Genesis when the man of God, Isaac, did not have a child. Then the Bible says he went to pray, and when he prayed for the wife, God was entreated. So which means God answered the prayers of this man, Isaac. The Bible has used the same word for David. David was not praying here. He was offering sacrifice to God on the altar. And the Bible says God, which means when you sacrifice. You know when Noah came out of the ark, he raised an altar and he sacrificed to the Lord. Genesis chapter 8 verse 20. And God smelled a sweet incense, sweet aroma. And he said, I make a covenant that I'll never destroy man with water. And as long as the earth remains, seed time, winter and summer, day and night, shall not cease. After the sacrifice was put on the altar, then God made a covenant that we are benefiting from. Covenants are made as sustained on the altars. You know, we can debate about altars, but let's not debate about sacrifice. We can't. When Ananias and Sapphira, they died because they gave 50% to God. After selling their property, their own property, they were supposed to bring 100%. After giving half, they died. Brethren, the gospel, this Christianity is a product of sacrifice. And anyone who is lying to you that just say bragada, bragada, things will happen, that's why people are going into witchcraft. Because if you are kufunga, file karipa. If you are kupepa, file posenjita. But if you are shortcut, Jesus was offered by the devil, just bow before me and I'm going to give you whatever you want. That's why a lot of people are doing, they are going to bow before the devil. They are kissing the feet of Lucifer just to get miracles, just to get money, just to get marriages, just to get power. It is an abomination. It will lead you to hell. It is very temporary. Very, very temporary. Listen, I'm warning you. It is very temporary. Soon, He who is to come will come and will judge the world. And you rotten hell. I have no apologies. What does it profit a man to gain the whole world and lose his soul? On the earth, you have a following. You are a papa. People, oh, papa, oh, papa. Then you rot in hell for the rest of your life. Come on, man. It doesn't pay. It doesn't pay. My last scripture, and I'll be closing. Judges chapter number 20. Judges chapter number 20. So all the children of Israel came out from Dan to Beersheba, as well as from the land of Gilead, and the congregation gathered together as one man before the Lord at Mizpah. Okay. And the leaders of the children of the people, all the tribes of Israel, presented themselves in the assembly of the people of God, 400,000 foot soldiers who drew the sword. Now the children of Benjamin heard that the children of Israel had gone up to Mizpah. And the children of Israel said, "Tell us, how did this wicked deed happen?" Okay. Okay, I want to go down a bit. Judges. Hallelujah. Okay, I think we are going to read from verse 16. Judges chapter 20, from verse 16. Well, let me start from verse 15. And from there, cities at the time, the children of Benjamin numbered 26,000 men who drew the sword, besides the inhabitants of Gibeah, who numbered 700 select men. Among all these people were 700 select men who were left-handed. Everyone could sling a stone at a hair's breadth and not miss. Now, besides Benjamin, the men of Israel numbered 400,000 men who drew the sword, and all these were men of war. And the children of Israel arose and went up to the house of God and inquired of God, and they said, "Which of us shall go up first to battle against the children of Benjamin?" Listen. Verse 18, then the children of Israel arose and went up to the house of God to inquire of God. And they said, "Which of us shall go up first to battle against the children of Benjamin?" The Lord said, "Judah must go first." The Lord said, "Judah must go first." So the children of Israel rose early in the morning and encamped against Gibeah. And the men of Israel went out to battle against Benjamin. And the men of Israel put themselves in battle array and fought against them at Gibeah. And the children of Benjamin came out of Gibeah and on that day cut down to the ground 22,000 men of the children of Israel. The children of Israel went to God and asked, "Should we go and fight?" God said, "Go, and Judah must go in front." Judah means praise. Let singers go in front. God allowed them to go to this battle. God is the one who called them. God is the one who gave them the mandate. God is the one who prophesied. God is the one. God spoke and they went, but they got defeated. The fact that you are called does not mean things will be rosy. There are certain things you need to do. This life is more spiritual than physical. I want to show you something. Then the children of Israel came to Gibeah. Okay, I've read verse 22. And the people, that is the men of Israel, encouraged themselves and again formed the battle line at the place where they had put themselves in array on the first day. So they went for the second. I'm thinking, that should have been a mistake. But God told us to go. And he said, Judah must go first. How come? I thought this marriage, God is the one who gave me. How come? I thought God is the one who gave me this child. How come? How come? How come? How come? Then the children of Israel went up and wept before the Lord. until evening and ask counsel of the Lord, saying, shall I go again to draw near for battle against the children of my brother Benjamin? And the Lord says, go up against him. Now, after they were defeated, 22,000 men were killed. The Bible says they went to God. They cried the whole day. They prayed the whole day. They prayed the whole day. And on top of praying, they consulted God. Should we go for battle against Benjamin? Listen to the answer God gave them. And the Lord said, go up against him. Verse 24. So the children of Israel approached the children of Benjamin on the second day. And Benjamin went out against them from Gibeah on the second day and cut down to the ground 18,000 more from 22 pin, another 18 pin. There's a... How it is a movie. He's the one who said go. But you know what? God expects you to be wise. To know that in this battle, you don't go empty-handed. You need an altar that is backing you. You need a sacrifice. There must be something that is speaking for you. Wow. Verse 27. Then all the children of Israel, verse 26, all the children of Israel, that is all the people, went up and came to the house of God and wept. And they sat there before the Lord and fasted. Now they have included fasting. They were just praying. The first one, they just inquired. There was no prayer. The first one, they just spoke to God. God said, go. The second one, they prayed the whole day. There was no fasting. The third one, they added fasting. They sat there before them and fasted that day until evening, and they offered burnt offerings and peace offerings before the Lord. If you follow what I talked about David, he offered burnt offerings and peace offerings. That was a sacrifice. They have added fasting. They have added burnt offerings. They have added peace offerings. They have added, in essence, a sacrifice before God. I want to show you what happened thereafter. And the children of Israel inquired of the Lord. The ark of the covenant of God was there in those days. And Phinehas and the son of Eleazar, the son of Aaron, stood before it in those days, saying, shall I yet again go out to battle against the children of my brother Benjamin, or shall I cease? And the Lord says, go up, for tomorrow I'll deliver them into your hands. Now, God's statement is longer here. He says, go up, for tomorrow I will deliver them into your hands. God is now very precise. After prayer, fasting, and the sacrifice. Then Israel set men in ambush all ground of Gibeah. And the children of Israel went up against the children of Benjamin on the third day and put themselves in battle array against Gibeah as the other time. And the children of Benjamin went out against the people and were drawn away from the city. They began to strike down and kill some of the people as at the other times in the highways, one of which goes to Bethel and the other Gibeah. And in the field, about 30 men of Israel were killed. They killed 30, and the children of Benjamin, they thought they are conquering. The Bible says, then the children of Benjamin said, they are defeated before us as at first. But the children of Israel said, let us flee and draw them away from the city to the highways. So all the men of Israel rose from their place and put themselves in a battle array at Baal-Tama. And then Israel's men in ambush burst forth from their position in the plain of Geba. And the 10,000 select men from all Israel came against Gibeah. And the battle was fierce. But the Benjamites did not know that disaster was upon them. The Benjamites did not know that disaster was upon them, because people had sacrificed. This time, they came dangerous. The first time, they didn't come with a sacrifice. Second time, they didn't come with a sacrifice. This one, they have erected an altar. They have offered peace offering and burnt sacrifices before the Lord. My God. The Bible says, verse 35, then the Lord defeated Benjamin before Israel, and the children of Israel destroyed that day 25,100 Benjamites, all them that drew the sword. God got involved when man came to the altar of sacrifice, when man knew that sacrifice is what was missing in all these journeys they went and got defeated. When they made up their minds to sacrifice, God got involved. If you read your Bible in 1 Samuel chapter 7, you read the whole chapter. When you come down there, you find that the children of Israel went to Mizpah and they poured water and repented before God. Then the Philistines came and surrounded them. Then the Bible says the man of God, Samuel, took the lamb and put it on the altar and begin to sacrifice. And the children of Israel said to Samuel, do not stop talking to your God. Keep on sacrificing. As they are drawing closer, continue sacrificing. The Bible says, as Samuel was sacrificing and the enemies were drawing closer, the Lord thundered against the Philistines. The most dangerous person in this earth is a man and a woman who understand sacrifice. Your life, your position in life is as a result of sacrifice. Your sacrifice is what determines your position in this life. In the spiritual realm, you have no essence and value if your life lacks sacrifice. Never allow any man talk you away from sacrifice, because even God, to win us to him, he had to sacrifice his son. In this kingdom, you lose to gain. In this kingdom, you rise by going down. In this kingdom, you gather by scattering. The Bible says, I know him who scatters and has much, and I know him who gathers and has nothing. Jesus says, if you want to have your life, then you must lose it. Unless the seed falls to the ground and dies, it abideth alone. Unless the seed falls to the ground and dies, it abideth. Without death, there is no multiplication. I urge you therefore, brethren, that you present your bodies as a living sacrifice, holy and acceptable before the Lord. Sacrifice. The power of sacrifice. There is a story in 2 Kings chapter 3. Please, you can read. 3 Kings. Jehoshaphat, Jehoram. 3 kings are going against Moab to fight. And then they said, we need to find out from one man of God. They said, there is Elisha who was working with Elijah. They went to consult him, and Elisha told them a word of the Lord to say, go and fight, for God has given. You know Elisha is a prophet. You know Elisha. He gives them a word from the Lord. After the music is played, the Spirit of the Lord comes upon him. He prophesies. He says, go, God will give them into your hands. And the Bible says Israel was winning. And the Moabite king was stressed. The battle was fierce against him. He remained with 700 men, and he flee and he ran away. But when he realized that the battle was becoming fierce against him, the Bible says in 2 Kings chapter 3, that is my last scripture, and I'll be closing. 2 Kings chapter 3, the Bible says in verse 26 and 27, verse 26, the Bible says, when the king of Moab saw that the battle was too fierce for him, he took with him 700 men who drew swords to break through to the king of Edom, but they could not. 27. Then he took his eldest son, who would have reigned in his place, and offered him as a burnt offering. He took his son as a burnt offering. One thing that you should know is that Satan, Lucifer, he received the sacrifice of human blood. God doesn't. There is no scripture in the Bible where God received the blood of man as sacrifice. It's not there. It's not there. If you read your Bible very well, that's why David, when the men broke into the camp of the Philistines and collected water for him, he says it's as good as drinking your blood, because that water was stained with blood, because those guys, they had to fight three against thousands upon thousands to get that water. David says, you were as good as dead men. I cannot drink this water. He poured it on the ground, because God does not receive the sacrifice of human blood. But this king offered his son to a strange God, a wrong God. But in the spiritual realm, they follow the principle. Because he has sacrificed, the Bible says, and there was great indignation against Israel. So they departed from, they could not continue fighting him. Israel was in problems. That's why you see, Avena Kristo, alikuata shop kukamuala, upper town center. Then you munanko akuata shop next. Emma 04, enchanting to his God. Enchanting. When he opens the shop, first he closes behind. He goes to the counter and speaks certain things. When it is 13-hour sharp, he closes the shop to go and worship his God. He were blind and foolish that, no, I'm a Christian. Okay. The principle of sacrifice works. There is power in the sacrifice. Try it. It has worked for me. That's why I don't fear the devil. I don't even fear his agents. I don't fear them. No, I don't. Because I know that the one in me is greater. I know the secret is sacrifice. Live a life of sacrifice. God will always come for the people that sacrifice. Today I just came to encourage you on the power of sacrifice. I hope that you are blessed. I hope that the Lord has spoken to you, and I hope that you are encouraged. Do not forget to go to church tomorrow. Tomorrow is Sunday, please. Make sure that you go to the house of the Lord. Let's pray together. Father, I stretch my hands and pray for everyone that was tuned in and listening to your word. The intake of your word brings forth life, light. So I bless my audience and declare by the Spirit of the Lord that the hand of the Lord rest upon them. Those who are sick in the body, I command healing to flow right now. I command healing. I command tumors to disappear right now. Shoulder pain to go. Shoulder pain to go right now. Fibroids now. I command you to dissolve. I command you to dissolve. I command you to dissolve every migraine headache. I rebuke you right now in the name of Jesus. Everywhere where you are feeling pain, arthritis, somebody has got pain in your right leg, just here on top here, from the knee going down, on top here, you have a very terrible sharp pain on your right leg, very terrible pain. I command that pain to go right now in the blessed name of Jesus. Be healed. Father, I pray for them who are believing you for the fruit of the womb. Open that womb, Lord. Grant them the desires of their heart. Those who are trusting you for marriages, Lord, connect them to the right partners. Those who have children who are sick, those who have children who are in rehab, addictions, I pray that the evil spirit of addiction be broken. Bring healing to that marriage, Jehovah God. Oh, Holy Spirit, do the rest. Take over from me now and touch your people. Touch your people. Touch your people. Touch them. They are your people. Let your anointing flow and break every yoke of bondage. Let every yoke be broken. Somebody, you feel heaviness on your back, like you are carrying something very heavy. I command that burden to be lifted. In the name of Jesus, be free. Jesus has set you free. Now, amen. May the God, Lord bless you. Thank you for your time. I'm grateful and I'm praying that the Lord will preserve your life. We'll meet again on Saturday. Shalom, shalom. Bye. There's an